And to
the,
Allan,
the other thing, George, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He didn't say, I'll show you a way. He didn't say, I'll show you the truth. He didn't say, I'll show you that. He said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. That's why we know it's real. It's the right one.
Excellent. Thank you, guys. That's a good start. So, Allan, would you like to tell us about what's about to happen this coming Monday night, please?
Yes, just want to tell you, every Monday night at 8 o'clock UK time, we have a Life Stories program. It's on YouTube, it's on Zoom, it's on Facebook. You can find out the details by going to bmflifestories.com, or you can join on YouTube at Life Stories at Lunch. You can go on there, you can subscribe on there. But on Monday night, we have an interesting story this coming Monday, tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Jamie Jones Buchanan, who was a rugby player with Leeds Rhinos until only recently, played many, many years for Leeds Rhinos. And he's now a coach with Leeds Rhinos. He's played over 400 games, I think, altogether. But he's going to be sharing his life story tomorrow night. At 8 o'clock. You don't want to miss it. We ask you to join us tomorrow night for Life Stories at 8 o'clock.
Thank you, Allan. Well, we've heard a little bit about what is a Christian, and you can ask us more, of course. You can phone the number on the screen here, or you can go to, as Allan said, bmflifestories.com, and you can get more information and contact us. But following on from our earlier question, what is a Christian? And you gave us some great in-depth answers to what a Christian is and what the Bible says. But the next question is, and I'll come to Pastor Keith on this one, what isn't a Christian?
That's a good question, because a lot of people will come under the banner of Christian.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of organizations, a lot of groups of people. And Jesus makes it plain that if you are born again, if you've accepted him, you're a Christian. So outside of that is not a Christian. And for a while, when in my younger days of Christianity, I stopped using the word Christian because people were getting confused. Because they were like, oh, are you this? Are you that? So I used to just call myself a follower of Jesus. And that kind of just made it clear. Like, I was just really wanting to follow Jesus. Really, if you're saying what's not a Christian, it's someone who's rejected Jesus, rejected the truth, someone who's living by their own kind of laws, their own standards, someone who's not paying attention to the Spirit, someone who's even claiming the name of Jesus. Jesus says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter into heaven. And when I used to read that as a young man, that used to scare me, because I'm like, am I really a Christian? But actually being bothered by that question, was good evidence that the Spirit was in me to bother me about that, and to constantly check, am I growing the fruits of the Spirit, love, patience, kindness, goodness? Are these evidence in me? Because Jesus says, you will know them by their fruits. So there's evidence of what a Christian is and what a Christian isn't. And really, it's someone who could even take the title of Christianity for one reason or another reason, and then not live it. They could say, oh, I'm a Christian verbally, but actually in the heart there'd be no change. So it's someone who hasn't got that change of heart. I hope that's
awesome. Sound, guys. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I've lost sound.
We can hear you, George.
Can hear you.
I've lost my sound.
Can hear you.
We can hear you, George. Just carry on.
Are there any traits or behaviours that marks a person as a Christian?
Is that the key?
Can you hear me? Oh, that sound.
When we were talking about what isn't a Christian, you know, it's a great question, isn't it? And you know, I had a look on Wikipedia. Wikipedia's great. You found all kinds of stuff on there. And on there, it talks about there's 2.2 billion people that are said to be Christians. I don't think there's 2.2 billion people that go to church regularly.
Yeah.
And I think just because I was born in England, which is a Christian country, doesn't make me a Christian. It's, as Des said early on, being a Christian is not only believing in Jesus, but also having a relationship with him. And so it starts with believing in Jesus. And the Bible says that all of sin, everybody's done wrong and fallen short of God's glory. So being good doesn't get you over the line, but having a relationship with Jesus because you believe in him is the beginning of being a Christian. And what comes after that is an absolute adventure. So that's how I look at it. You ain't a Christian. You isn't a Christian just because you're born in a Christian country. Has everybody got it? Is it just me? On?
That's a good point.
Sorry, I've lost my sound, guys. Allan, can you tell us as well, please, what it is not to be a Christian?
Well, I think one thing about not being a Christian, people who think they just do good works. People think if they help people, they give money to the poor, they do things like that, they think that it's a Christian. It's not. It's not a Christian. It's good to do that. The first thing is, you come to Christ first, then you do the works. It's not by works that we're saved. It's by grace we are saved through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. Because people could say, well, I do so much. I go to church. I give so much money to this organization, to this charity, to that charity. I go and help the homeless. I feed the poor. That doesn't make a person a Christian. But some people think it does. No, it's a relationship, as I said before. That's the only way you can have, you'll be a Christian, is have that relationship with Jesus.
Thank you. I've just got my sound back.
George, the word Christian is Christianos, and it was actually a derogatory term given to those people who wouldn't denounce Christ as their Lord in the early days. And they were burnt at stakes, they were thrown into prisons, they were fed to lions. You know, it's somebody who follows Jesus and is Christ-like. It means Christ-like. So the word Christian means Christ-like. You've got to check out, was I Christ-like before? No, I'm not even like it now. I'm being made Christ-like, because that's what the Father promises. When you give your life to the Lord, he's turning you more like his Son. And that means our character, how we respond, our choices. We make God-given choices rather than selfish ones. And the process is dying to self. You know, I was in the way. That's what it took 42 years before I actually made a decision. And then there's that battle. Even when you've done it, there's the old you. And the Christian knows there's the old me and there's a new creation. God has made me a new creation. That's a Christian. You know, and it's to be experienced. And it'd be difficult, you know, if I was to talk to someone who's never had sex, you wouldn't know. You know, I could tell him what it feels like and what it's like, but he wouldn't know, or she wouldn't know. Right? But me, and it's the same with meeting Jesus. I know that's putting it on the board there, but this is the truth. You would know, they'd have a parallel knowing. And I would know very quickly that someone that thinks they're a Christian, but they're quite not there. You know, and there is a process, as Keith said. It's a process that we work through.
Excellent. I mean, you mentioned the word a new creation. Surely it is not a new creature, because, I mean, it says in John 3, you must be born again. So you're a new creature rather than a creation? Anybody? Allan?
A new being.
A new being.
A new being, really. Yeah.
Okay, excellent. But looking around the world, there are many, many people who are very good people. They don't harm anyone. They're very generous. They're very kind. They're loving. And they have everything that appears to be what is Christ-like, in that, you know, giving, loving. What would you say to those people then, if, you know, about being Christian or not Christian?
Well, I would say to them, right, when you stand before God, if you want to go into heaven, you stand at the gate of heaven, and God says to you, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say? You say, well, I've been good. I've gone to church. I've been kind to people. I've never told lies. I don't steal. Never killed anybody. Never done anything really wrong. What would God say to you? He would say, What have you done with Jesus? What is your relationship with Jesus? That's the only thing that matters that will get you into heaven. Not your good works, but what did you do with my son, Jesus? Do you know him? Have you been born again? That's the most important thing.
You guys have mentioned born again several times. How does a person actually become born again? Simply. Billy.
Well, a person's spirit is dead because of Adam's sin. When Adam and Eve sinned, their spirits died. And death means separation from God. They're separated from God. And every person is born with a sin nature, even a little baby. You don't have to teach children how to do wrong or to tell lies or to steal. They have a sin nature. And that sin nature has to be dealt with. Our spirits are dead. But when we ask Jesus into our life, our Holy Spirit causes our spirits to be reborn. We begin that new life. That's being born again. It's our spirit that is reborn.
Amen.
Billy, you were going to add to that?
Yeah, Jesus says, marvel not that I said to you, you must be born again. And he also said in that passage, he said, you must be born of water and spirit. And I look at the being born of water is your first birth. You pass through water, your mother gives break, the waters break, and you come into this world. And then somewhere along the line, there's this other birth which says that you'd be born of the Spirit. And to be born of the Spirit, it's when we're born on this earth, earth is our domain. Earth is where we belong. But when we're born of the Spirit, there's another domain which is called heaven, which is called eternal life. And to be born of the Spirit is to be born with the domain or the kingdom of heaven being a destination, a destiny. And one day we will all pass over the final door into eternal life and born into that eternal life. And so I believe that, I think sometimes people can get confused or caught up with the actual word born again, and it becomes a byword, or, people go around, I'm a born again Christian, and then other people say, oh, I'm just a Christian. I like what Keith said, when Keith said about he was a follower of Jesus. In fact, in the Bible, that's what the early Christians were called, followers of the way. And it was, I think it was in Antioch where they was first described and given the title Christians or Christ-like, because what happened in Antioch, they were doing exactly the same thing that Jesus did, and they were like little Jesuses, if you like. And so they recognized that, hey, these people are doing exactly the same as Jesus, exactly the same as Christ. They are Christ ones, Christians. And I suppose that's what we should start to become, that kind of a Christian. But what does a Christian do is for next week.
Okay, if I could come to Keith on that one. We've mentioned about, the guys have mentioned about being born again and coming to know Jesus, but surely God is a loving God and he loves everybody and wouldn't, you know, condemn anybody or send them to hell or anything else. Surely his love extends to that.
Well, you got to remember as well, we've got a God who's right and just, and a just God cannot allow sin to be in his presence. It's almost like, If God was saying, oh, if you do this, I'll do this, but never following through, it'd be like one of those bad parents you see in the street who are saying, you do it one more time and this will happen, and the kid does it and they don't do anything. If there's no consequence, then there's no reason to live by any laws that God gives us. But God has given us the Ten Commandments, and he has given us those laws because he's not just the law giver, but he's the law keeper. But because we broke the law, we needed Jesus. And this is the wonderful thing about the gospel and being a Christian, that we can't keep that law, because if we could, we wouldn't need Jesus. But because we broke the law, we need Jesus. And Jesus is our rescuer of hell. Now, if you're thinking to yourself, well, I'm going to just stand before God and say, oh, your Bible says you loved me. Yes, he does love us, but it's a conditional love of accepting Jesus and then allowing that to change us. This isn't a love that's for anyone who wants to reject him. But not only that, but for people who live a whole life rejecting God, I always like to challenge them, well, where are you going to go when you die? And if they say heaven, I say, well, who do you think runs heaven? And they'll go, oh, well, God. And I'm like, yeah, but you don't care or want to know God now. So when you're in heaven, that's going to be eternally with a God that you don't love or care about. So why would you want to be there anyway? So they're almost rejecting God. God's not punishing them, but they're rejecting God because God's gave them away the heaven. And we need to remember that the Bible tells us that hell was designed for Satan and the angels who fell. But unfortunately, Satan's deceived us into following him rather than following God. I hope that's answered your question.
Thank you, Keith, yes. Yeah. So we've learned about what it's not to be a Christian. We've also learned about the consequences of not being a Christian. And Allan, if you'd like to tell us again a bit about what's about to happen again on Monday night, please.
Yeah, but just before I do that, George, I just want to say this. There's a saying I use quite often, it's this. If you're born once, you will die twice. If you're born twice, you'll only die once. That's something you can really think about tonight. Just ponder on that. If you're born once, you will die twice, because the Bible speaks of a second death, which is separation from God forever. But if you're born twice, the only death you'll face is a physical one. And if Jesus comes while you're still alive, you won't even face that. Okay, yeah, just to tell you again, Monday night, we have a Zoom live stories. It'll be on Facebook, it's on YouTube, but it's a life story on Monday night of Jamie Jones Buchanan, who is a former rugby player with Leeds Rhinos. He only retired recently, played many years for Leeds Rhinos. He's now a coach there at Leeds Rhinos. He has his own films as well, and he helps people. He does a lot of wonderful work, but he has a wonderful story to tell on Monday night. And just to tell you, if you have any needs or you want prayer, you can see the number which is on the screen now. You can phone in, there'll be people there to help you. It's 07-943-55-0287. If you phone that line, you'll either get an answer straight away or soon afterwards someone will be in touch with you. You can phone, you can text, you can email, you can leave a message on that phone. But that's the helpline if you need help tonight, our prayer line.
Okay. Just to go back on one of the questions about God's unconditional, we have had a question come in about God's unconditional love. Okay. Who would like to, Billy, perhaps you would like to answer that one.
Yeah, no problem.
God's unconditional love.
God, it's true. God's love towards us is unconditional. Just the same as our love towards him should be unconditional. You know, when you think of this unconditional love, the unconditional love of God came in the person of Jesus. And in John 3:16 says, whoever should believe in him, should not perish but have everlasting life. And if you think about it, have you ever heard the saying, George, if it's too good to be true, it probably is. I want to tell you something. I've got some news for you. Being a Christian, going to heaven, gaining eternal life, some people would say, if it's too good to be true, it probably is. Well, this is good to be true. Let me tell you a story what happened. When I first became a Christian, and I was talking to my friends about being about Jesus and what you need to do to be saved, to have eternal life. And I was annoying this guy. He was so annoyed. He said, we're going to lose our friendship if you don't behave. Why do you keep telling me? And this guy used to like bet on horses. And I said, if you got a tip from the stable on a horse that couldn't lose, that it was the best thing, it was the most certain horse to win a race ever, what would you do? He said, I'll put everything on it. I'd put my shirt on it. I'd put my house on it. I said, would be anything else? He said, I'd tell my friends about it. I said, I've found that horse. I've found the horse that cannot lose. His name is Jesus. That's why I put everything, all my life on it. And it came unconditionally. I didn't have to do anything apart from, I believe you, Jesus, and I give my life to you. Unconditional love. Amazing.
Thank you. Des, unconditional love, as Billy mentioned, surely there must be some condition, apart from Billy's description, because Keith mentioned about if we don't follow his laws, if we don't take Jesus, we'll end up in hell. So can you just expound on that a little bit for us, please?
Well, God doesn't want anybody to go there. That's why he asked his son, would he go to the cross? I mean, he gave up his own son's life. So he's made a way that no one has to go. Mm-hmm. And so it's choice in the end. People are choosing. They're blinded by the God of this world, the Bible says. But there's always a moment in time when God will reveal himself and then somebody has a choice what to do. Most people will say, oh, I did feel something, you know, but they don't pursue it enough. I didn't pursue things enough. So it was 42 when I actually started pursuing it. And it's when life for me came to a place where, what's this all about? You know, and I started praying. And they were the only honest prayers. I remember praying an honest prayer saying, I need to know what love is. I didn't know what love was about. And that was the first time I was honest in my heart, praying an honest prayer to God, sinner. He heard it. And he made a way for me to go to church for the first time since I was 15. You know, I mean, to see a service, that is. There'd be no wedding, funeral, all the different Christian things that can go on. But to listen to a service, and I'm on a business trip, and I went there. And it was revealed to me that my sin was totally revealed. So you can't come to Jesus without really knowing that you have sinned. And there's no arguments, I knew. And I had a choice to say sorry. And I got on my knees and wept. I wept for 40 minutes. I didn't know that was going to happen. But boy, it was the best experience I've ever had in my life. And I was filled with this indescribable joy as soon as I made a commitment. And life has changed since. It totally changed. So there was a transformation as well. And normally there's a transformation for people. And it's to be sought after. You know, like a boy wants a bike for Christmas and he pulls his dad's, you know, shirt all the time. Can I have one? And he says, write to Father Christmas. And the dad's worried how he's going to pay for this bike, but he does his best to get it for his son. You know, God has done it. He has provided for us. And the greatest gift is knowing Jesus. And from that, it brings satisfaction like there's no tomorrow. I didn't want anything else. I just wanted to serve him now because of what he'd done for me. And that's what I would say. Unconditional love. He'll always keep coming. That person who's saying no, he'll keep coming even to their last breath. That's unconditional love. Just because they turned away from him, he won't turn away from them. He'll keep knocking the door. Choice. But life harms hearts, but God can soften them.
Thank you, Des. So, Allan, would it be safe to say then that God's love is unconditional, but if we don't accept that love and accept Jesus, there will be consequences?
Certainly will. Yeah. God has made a way for us. God so loved the world, and that means you, whoever's listening, you could put your own name in there. God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son, whoever, that's included, that's you, believes in him, will not perish, but will have everlasting life. So if you receive Jesus, you receive everlasting life. If you don't receive, you perish. There's two choices. And then God asked me, he said, where will you spend eternity? And there's two choices, heaven or hell. Heaven with Jesus, the hell with Satan. You choose. You've got the opportunity to make that decision.
Okay. George, Joe, when he went to the cross, there was three criminals supposed to go to the cross. One was called Barabbas, and it was the other two, they're not named. And they went to get Barabbas. Barabbas thought he was going to be walked to the cross. They opened the door, and when they went in, he said, you're free to go. Jesus is dying in your place. Barabbas was free to go. Jesus was put in the cross, and there was two men on your side of him. One spat at him, one was cursing him. The other knew that Jesus lived a life not like theirs. They were criminals. And you had to do something bad to go on a cross. And this man says to him, remember me in paradise. But those words came from a heart that knew he was a sinner and needed a savior. And Jesus turned to him and said, today you'll be with me in paradise. And that's really the answer. Even then, at that last moment, for that, two criminals were freed. But one heart was so hard, he stayed on the cross. And unfortunately, he's away from God now. And that's like an example we get out of the Bible to show really what it's all about. They get opportunity. That's unconditional love. God always wants to keep throwing his love at us. And we can't earn it. We can't earn it. It's free. We've got to learn that we can't earn this love. It's just there for us. Just like our children, when our children learn to walk and they fall over, we're actually delighted that they've just taken those steps. And we're encouraging them, you know, to have another go. God wants to keep coming to show that he loves them. And he'll do anything he can to show them. But they have to make the choice.
Thank you, Dave. Okay.
I think it's important, George, to say that it says in the Bible, God does not take any pleasure in the death of the wicked.
No, that's right.
He's not there wanting to destroy people. It doesn't matter how bad a person's been. I've been in prisons in Uganda and met killers and rapists and murderers. But, you know, when they come to Jesus, they become that new creation we talked about. God takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He wants everyone. It says, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to everlasting life, to know him. But sadly, people choose. As somebody mentioned before, you make the choice.
Thank you. So, Keith, coming back to you, we've heard about God's unconditional love, and we've also heard about the consequences. How easy is it for someone to become part of this unconditional love?
How easy
is it to become part of it and become, you know, but experience God's love?
To become a Christian?
Yes.
It's really easy. It's as easy as opening your mouth and just talking to God and asking Jesus to come into your life. It's that easy. It's the growth that's the hard part afterwards, I think. Growing in Jesus and understanding that. I remember going to church as a young person and being what you would call a church kid. I was. I knew the language. I knew the right things to say to get the sweets in Sunday school. I was all that. And then I remember one day being in the middle of a field and the Holy Spirit almost hit me. And it was like God was saying to me, are you serious about following me? Because I'd been playing Christianity. I'd been playing the two fields. And in that moment, right there and then, I had to decide, am I going to be fully in for Jesus or am I going to be fully out? Thankfully, I was fully in for Jesus. But I didn't have to do any tests. I didn't have to do any spelling. It was just in that moment making that decision, am I in or am I out? And there's lots of Christians, I believe, who are saved. They know Jesus. They're going to heaven. But the real question is, are they growing as a disciple? Are they doing the work? Are they growing in that unconditional love? Because there's some people who can be saved and Jesus is going to be their ticket to heaven. But when they stand before God and their works are tested, it's going to go up in flames. But there's those who are growing in Jesus and being a disciple. And there's a big difference between just knowing Jesus and being a disciple of Jesus, being a true follower, someone who's wanting to grow in knowledge, in the word and deed of God, if that makes sense.
Yes, it does. Thank you. I'll just go to Billy on that one. Billy, Keith mentioned about Christians playing both sides, okay? Is that possible to be a Christian and you play both sides? Or how could I grow to become a fruitful Christian?
You know, when we talk about playing both sides, people do that. I think people do that even now. See, God gave us the greatest gift that he could ever give us, and that was a freedom of choice. We've got free will. He doesn't dictate to us. He doesn't tell us what we should do, what we shouldn't do. He leaves it up to us to decide. And I think sometimes we put a toe in one side and a toe in the other side, and we're unstable in everything that we do. Playing the field is great, but one day you're going to have to decide which side of that line you're going on. And it's your decision. And you do it. But you think, yeah, I think I see a lot of it. I see a lot of people that are, that I think want to know more, but they just don't know how to find it. And I think also Christianity always seems to pose a greater commitment than anything else. Yeah, everything that Jesus has promised, everything that's in the Bible is free. It's a free choice that we can make. But yeah, people do. People do toss between one and the other. And I think somewhere along the line, you've got to say, because one day we're not going to be in this earth anymore. One day it'll happen. And then is that too late to make a choice? Do it now. Have a go. When I was faced with the choice of heaven or hell, I chose heaven. And if you ask people, which one would you prefer to be in, heaven or hell? I would say the majority of people would say heaven. And yeah, but how do I get there? Well, it's simple. Just say, Jesus, I believe in you. I accept you. I believe that you died for me. And I just want to give my life over to you. You gave your life over to me. And let's make a deal. Let's say yes. It's simple. But people, I don't know. They just step in and step out. Just do it. Just get it done.
Excellent.
And decide.
So, Allan, can we just tell us, please, what will be happening again on Monday night, please?
Yeah, Monday night, we have at 8 o'clock UK time, we have our Zoom live story. It'll be on Facebook, it's on YouTube, and you can watch this at 8 o'clock. We have on Monday night Jamie Jones Buchanan, a former rugby league player with the Leeds Rhinos, who is now a coach there with the Leeds Rhinos, fulfilled his childhood ambition. A great guy, and he's got a wonderful story to share on Monday night. So please join us. You can also go on to Live Stories at Lunch and watch this. You can find out more on bmflivestories.com about this. But tell other people. We want you to spread the good news about this wonderful Jesus that he'll be sharing about.
Thank you, Allan. Des, question for you. I've made my decision. I want to become a Christian. I become a Christian. How do I grow and become deeper with Christ and get to know Father better?
Well, the first thing, you want to become a Christian, so we would say a prayer and ask God to forgive us of our past and ask him to help us with our growth. And when you ask that, he's going to send his Spirit to come and help you. So the first thing is to ask the Holy Spirit daily to lead you and help you, to guide you. I asked for him to take me to church because I knew the church I was in the past wasn't right. And I just knew in my spirit at that time. And so God led that man to show me the path. But I'd asked. And that was the Holy Spirit leading me. We like to pick the word up. Before I read the word, I'm going to ask God for his Spirit to enlighten the word, to reveal the word to me. I'm going to pray. I pray. I didn't want to pray when I first got saved. But I'm up in bed thinking, what do you pray about? Now there isn't enough time to pray. Everything needs prayer. You realize that everything should be taken to God in prayer. And it's because we don't take things to God in prayer that we grow slowly or we make errors in our way. It says in the Romans 12:2, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to test and approve what God's will is in his good, pleasing and perfect will. He does have a will for our lives, but he is right. He will let us choose. That's the God of love. The God of love lets you decide. But he does put something in your heart to get you in the word. But we fight our flesh with this, and we have to win this battle. And whichever one you feed the most would be the strongest in your life.
And how do I renew my mind? You mentioned that renewing your mind. Do I renew my mind?
You renew your mind by the washing of the word. The word of God, right, will wash you. It's Jesus. He is the living word. So the power is Jesus washing you of the things that are wrong that you've believed. And it's a process. And we can have many different things. That's why we shouldn't judge different Christians. Everybody's going through a different thing when they get saved. And what one is dealing with over on the right-hand side, the other one's already dealt with. And you can look over to this one thinking you shouldn't be doing that. But that's judgmentalism. We got to give grace to people because he gave grace to me. And it says in the word that you know my people because they're love they have for one another. It's how we respond. You know, the love of God is in us, and then we want the word of God in us so we understand his perfect will and its prayer and its relationship. So I can have a direct one up with God, and I have a parallel one through believers like yourself, George. You know, and we communicate, and I learn things about God through you. Today I've learned things as Billy's spoken, as Keith has spoken, as Alan's spoken. I've learned some things here. Excellent. You know, we're always learning. A Christian is open to learning. He's like a sponge. He wants to know more about Jesus, more about the truth, because you shall know the truth. Truth sets you free.
Thank you. Alan, Des mentioned about praying, praying every day for the Holy Spirit to guide you. A question's come in from Facebook asking, why do we pray to Jesus and not our Father in heaven as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, our Father who art in heaven?
Well, I generally pray to Father. Jesus said, ask the Father in my name. And if I pray, that's how I usually pray. I pray, Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I ask you to do this. And then I pray in the name of Jesus. That's what Jesus said we should do. But I believe the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit are one. So we can talk to any one of them. We can talk to the Father. We can talk to Jesus. We can talk to the Holy Spirit. Because all three are part of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Amen. Excellent. Keith, I have another question come in from Facebook asking, it comes from Zhang. It says, herbal remedies have cured his illness. What does God think of that?
I don't know. I'm not a doctor, and I don't know the ins and out of different medicines and herbals and stuff like that. All I do know is that when I became a believer and I grew as a believer, I wanted to rely more and more on the Lord for certain aspects of my life. And I gave over my health to him because as a child, I wasn't very well. And he brought me through that. And I know God's hand on my health. And so I gave that over to him. Now, this isn't a slight on anyone who has illnesses or anything your doctors are giving you. Please keep taking them. But I think it's important to ask yourself the question of why are we taking so much medication in the Western world and not being more reliant on God at times, certainly in certain areas. I mean, and this is just me personally, but when I get a headache, I don't automatically think I need paracetamol. I'd pray about it, or I'll go lie down and give myself 5-minute rest. And yet, people who automatically go for paracetamol, the paracetamol now isn't strong enough. And so you have to go for stronger stuff than paracetamol. And so I think it's important when we're thinking about different medicines and herbal and stuff like that, I think it's important to realize that our body is affected, and it is the Bible says it's a temple, and we should be careful with what we do with our bodies. And I think sometimes we just got to have a bit of faith and hand this stuff over to God. But when it comes to the herbal remedies, I'm not sure what herbal remedy is. But if the Lord's gave us it and it's bringing good, then yeah.
Good, okay.
Billy, have you answered the question without being controversial, sorry.
Billy, would you have any comment on that?
Yeah, you know, I think what we should do, we should always put God first. Do you know, everything in this world, it says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So everything in this world was given for our benefit. All the drugs, all the herbs, everything that we have in this world was for our benefit.
Yeah.
But we need to put God first. The Bible tells us that it says that if the sick among you call for the elders of the church, they will come and pray the prayer of faith, anoint you with oil, and the prayer of faith will heal the sick. And that is, for me, is putting God first. Somebody asked me and said, if you're sick, would you take medicine? Of course I would.
Yeah.
Because God's provided it. Everything in this world's for our benefit. Of course I would take medicine. But I was also include God in that process of healing. Our body's a great machine. Our body can heal itself from almost anything. But sometimes it needs help, outside help. That's why we have paracetamol. That's why we have all these other whether it's herbal or medicinal, whatever it is, it's there for our benefit, and we should embrace that, but always put God first. Go to him first. Usually when we're sick, we put God last. He's the last resort. We try everything else, and then we'll phone the pastor up and say, I've tried everything else. Is there anything he can do? No, let's put, in fact, you should put the pastor first. Ring him first. And say, what's your advice? And he'd say, take the medicine, and I'll pray with you. And I'll give you some Bible verses that you can quote, and together we can fight any disease. But put God first.
Thank you, Billy. There's a question coming for Des here. It says, Des, what would be the first tip you would give to a new believer to do?
The first tip, it would be read the word of God, and I would guide them based on talking to them, because each person's got a different issue in their life before they come to God, and there is such a large book. I would like it to affect them quicker, and so I would guide them to get a Bible and to read it slowly and to ask the Holy Spirit to help them, to open up the scriptures in order to guide them. Secondly, it would be a prayer life. And thirdly, it would be to seek a church, a local church. And I would help them with that. I would ask them whereabouts they live, and I'd be looking for them to get into fellowship with fellow believers. So you become who you mix with sometimes. You know, thieves, they band together, don't they? You know, and they keep each other where they're at. And so if you want to grow, you go to the place where people are growing, which is the church, local church. And it's all structured there in the local church. Discipleship, if I could disciple them, they're local to me, that I'd offer discipleship. And I'd also ask them to pray about certain aspects of their lives, that God would reveal to them things that they perhaps should not do now, because it could hinder their walk. So there'll be a number of things, George, based on where that person might be at.
And, of course, each person's walk is individual. Some grow quicker than others, of course.
Yeah. I tend to keep in touch with anybody I talk to. If I lend the Lord, I'll keep in touch with them for quite a number of weeks. And they know they can phone me and get advice. And it's good to keep in touch. So, you know, you've got to get into a Christian circle very quickly, I think.
Keith, have you any tips for persons who first steps of being a Christian?
I think Des nailed it. Just take it slowly. Remember, when it says you're born again, this is a new birth spiritually. So if you've got a newborn baby and you try to give them like too much food at once, they're going to choke and struggle, and it's not good for them. And that's what it means to go underneath someone who knows the word better than you, so they can almost feed you like a child, and then eventually you start to get the ability to read the Bible yourself. And so it's definitely important that once you're saved, to come under someone who knows the Bible a little bit more than you, so they can gently feed you, and then you start to read the Bible for yourself. And then even praying, I only learned to pray because I was in a prayer meeting. If that makes sense. I'm being in that prayer meeting, and it was like, oh, I want to pray like these guys. So I would half my prayer, and they didn't notice, thank goodness, was just a mixture of what they said first, because I wanted to learn how to pray the way these guys prayed.
Thank you, Keith. Have you any tips to add to the person who has, say, just become a Christian? First steps?
Go to church. Find a good church. I think it's absolutely essential that you find someone, a group of people that you can relate to, that you can talk to, and you'll find somebody in that church that's probably gone through the same things that you're going through, and so, you know, to talk to God, to pray, is to start your relationship with Him, and it starts slow, just like anything else, and George is right, and Keith's right, that you can't give people, new Christians, heavy stuff. You know, you don't give them a steak if they need milk. And the Bible talks about that. But get a good church. And also, what I'm trying to get into people is, make it your priority to go to church every week. I know it's difficult now in these circumstances, but make it your priority. Make it that it becomes a discipline, that you do it regardless of what anything else happens to be. I was lucky when I first became a Christian, because there was nothing going on a Sunday. there's only churches open, there's nothing else to do. But no, there's other distractions. But once you make that decision to go to church, keep on and keep on, and you'll find somebody in there, or they'll find you, that you can relate to and help you grow.
Thank you. And finally, to hand over to Allan. Allan, if you'd just sum up for us this evening, we've learned what a Christian is, what a Christian isn't, and what is Christianity. So if you'd like to sum up, and perhaps tell us, our people listening, how they can become a Christian.
Yeah. Yeah, tonight you've heard many times been mentioned about being born again. And we've explained to be born again, we need to acknowledge that we're sinners. We've broken God's law. We've all broken God's law. We've all done things wrong. And then we've got to turn from that, repent of it. I mean, it's turn away from our old thoughts, our old ways. But then to ask Jesus to come into our heart, into our life, and if we do that, he will come in and you will receive the gift of eternal. Someone said, is it easy? It is easy to become a Christian. It's a gift. If anyone gives you a gift, it only becomes yours when you take and receive it. And God offers to you the free gift of eternal life. You can't pay for it. You can't work for it. It's a free gift. And so right now, if you'd like to receive that gift of eternal life, I want you to pray a prayer sincerely with me. Mean it with all your heart. And tonight you can become a child of God. You can be born again. So pray this prayer sincerely with me right now. Lord Jesus Christ, I confess that I am a sinner because the Bible says we have all sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. And that includes me. But I believe, Jesus, that you died on the cross in my place. You took the punishment for my sins, and you poured out your precious blood to wash my sins away. Yeah. I repent of my sins. I turn away from them. I turn to you with all my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come into my life right now by your Spirit and give to me the free gift of eternal life. I receive you now. Thank you for coming into my life. Now I believe in my heart. And I confess with my mouth that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that God has raised him from the dead. And I thank you, Lord, for saving me, for making me a child of God. Help me from this day to live for you, to follow you, to get to know you more. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer sincerely tonight, you really meant it, contact us on this number that you see on the screen, 079-4355-0287. Let us know that you have prayed that prayer tonight and that you have made Christ your Lord and your Savior.
Thank you very much.
Doesn't mean everything's going to be perfect. Doesn't mean everything's going to. You might have more problems than you had before, but you'll have someone there to walk with you through every situation, and eventually take you to be with him in heaven forever.
Thank you, Allan. Before we go, Des, there's one prayer request come in. Can you please pray for Titus Hassan? Okay, he's spent 10 years in a refugee camp due to war. And it's in around Khartoum area. And he says that the just want to pray for him, basically, that God will bless him and save him.
Okay.
His name is Titus Hassan.
Father, we bring Titus Hassan to you right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we ask that you touch him by your Spirit. Lord, it's not by might, it's not by power. We're praying for your Holy Spirit to come. Lord, to to come with this man who's had a hard 10 years in a refugee camp. Lord, I believe he's crying out to know you. I pray, Lord, you would send your mission angels around him, Lord, to bring him into your kingdom, Father, because only your spirit can reveal Christ. And I pray right now, Lord, that you would reveal to him, even though he's had hardship, that you love him, that your son died for him, Lord, and that there's a way for him in this world, that you will give him life and life to the full. So I just lift him up to you right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Titan Hassan, Lord, from Sudan. I pray for him right now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, men, for the discussion. Thank you, Keith, Billy, Allan, and Des. Of course, we will be back next week at the same time, 8 o'clock on Facebook and YouTube. So thank you once again for watching, and you can find more information on our BMF Life Stories website. So take care and be blessed.
Very good. Very good. Excellent job, guys.
I'm very cautious here. I didn't come across like anti-vax.